Hello, my name is Lucia. I work for Ceres at the NOAA Labs in Boulder, Colorado. Sometimes I give tours of our facility. Today, I'd like you to join me as we take a glimpse at the science that's being done at the NOAA Labs in Boulder, Colorado. Welcome to the David Skaggs Research Center, or DSRC, home to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's Boulder, Colorado facility. NOAA was formed in 1970 by then-President Richard Nixon's executive order. That order combined the federal government's Weather Bureau, Bureau of Fisheries, Coast and Geodetic Survey, and a number of other environmental research organizations into one agency. NOAA has three main missions. One, to understand and protect changes in climate, weather, oceans, and coasts. Two, to share that knowledge and information with others. And three, to conserve and manage coastal and marine ecosystems and resources. DSRC is named after former Congressman David Skaggs, who represented Colorado's 2nd Congressional District from 1987 to 1999. Our current NOAA facility in Boulder was completed in 1998. There are close to 1,000 employees working at NOAA in Boulder. In this video, we will introduce just a few of the many groups at NOAA Boulder. Let's take a look at those groups now. Let's begin with the National Weather Service. The National Weather Service has 122 local forecasting offices. All these offices are staffed 24/7, every day of the year. Colorado has 4 forecast offices serving the state. Grand Junction forecasts for western Colorado, Pueblo forecasts for southeastern Colorado, and the office in our building in Boulder forecasts for northeastern Colorado. In far eastern Colorado, the forecast office in Goodland, Kansas, serves 3 counties along the state border. There are typically 2 to 3 forecasters on each 9-hour shift. One forecaster is focused on just today and tomorrow, and the other forecaster is focused on tomorrow through 7 days in the future. Forecasts are updated at least every 3 hours. Forecasters spend a lot of time communicating with government agencies and private companies affected by weather conditions. They regularly coordinate with local media, large and small airports, the Colorado Department of Transportation, and regional emergency management. How do forecasters know what the weather will look like? They use many tools. Weather balloons are released twice a day at 92 sites in the United States. Around the world, hundreds of weather balloons are released at the same time, twice every day. These balloons contain a radio sonde that measures wind speed, wind direction, humidity, temperature, and air pressure. There are many ground-level instruments across Colorado that measure the same things throughout the day. NOAA's GOES-16 and 17 satellites are stationed over North America and South America, giving forecasters constant coverage of Colorado, including smoke, cloud movement, lightning strikes, and moisture. Radar provides an inside view of storms, allowing forecasters to predict hail, tornadoes, and heavy snow. When forecasters need observations from people, they can call on many weather spotters in our region. Weather spotters are volunteers who have taken the free training from their local Weather Service office to safely provide accurate weather information. Lastly, weather models give forecasters an idea of what to expect in the future. Weather models are run on supercomputers using data from many sources, such as satellites, weather balloons, ground-level instruments, and airplanes. NOAA has created many weather models. The American model is run out of Washington, D.C. Researchers at NOAA Boulder have created and improved models, including the HER, used for short-term forecasts. You can see forecasts for northeastern Colorado at weather.gov/BOU. For other locations in the United States, go to weather.gov and type in the zip code or city and state. Now we're headed to the Space Weather Prediction Center. The Space Weather Prediction Center is an operational center within the National Weather Service and is one of two National Weather Service forecast offices located in Boulder, Colorado. The Space Weather Prediction Forecast Office is staffed 24/7 every day of the year, and its forecasters monitor the sun for space weather phenomenon and provide forecasts and warnings of space weather threats so users can mitigate impacts. So what are they looking for? There are many types of space weather events. However, three space weather-related storms are of particular note: solar flares, geomagnetic storms, and radiation storms. These phenomena all happen with increased frequency and stronger intensity as the sun's magnetic field becomes more chaotic, but less often as the sun's magnetic field stabilizes. This fluctuation in the sun is called the solar cycle and is about 11 years in length, having both a minimum and maximum of activity. More frequently, in and around solar maximum, localized strong magnetic fields may reveal themselves visibly as sunspots. When these magnetic fields become too stressed, they may instantly reconnect into less stressful alignments, causing sudden bursts of enormous amounts of electromagnetic energy, known as solar flares. Geomagnetic storms are disturbances in the Earth's magnetic field, usually caused by dramatic changes in the continuous outflow of particles and plasma streaming from the sun, called the solar wind. The more intense geomagnetic storms are usually a result of explosive releases of billions of tons of solar material into space, called a coronal mass ejection, or CME. CMEs also carry a strong embedded magnetic field along with them, furthering potential interactions with Earth's magnetic field and possibly leading to more intense geomagnetic storms. CMEs can reach Earth in as quick as 18 hours, but usually they arrive in 2 to 4 days. Radiation storms may take place when highly energetic protons suddenly accelerate along magnetic field lines stretching out from the sun into space. These storms are often associated with solar flares and CMEs and can reach Earth in as quick as tens of minutes. Most of us never notice space weather events because we are very well protected by our atmosphere and magnetosphere. So why does Space Weather Prediction Center forecast space weather? Because these types of space weather storms may impact our navigation technologies, radio communication, satellites, aviation, and spaceflight, and potentially the electrical power grid. More specific examples include: outside the atmosphere, astronauts' health may be severely affected by radiation storms, GPS can become less accurate, satellites can be bombarded with ions and negatively impact onboard electronics, certain radio bands can experience blackout conditions, making communication difficult or impossible for pilots and emergency workers. Even the power grid could become overwhelmed due to a sudden increase in current caused by severe or extreme geomagnetic storms. However, with warnings from the Space Weather Prediction Center, precautions and other protective measures may be taken in advance. There is one way you might see space weather in action, though. That is by the appearance of the aurora, the dancing, shimmering curtains of light in the night sky. The aurora appears when geomagnetic storms reach enough intensity due to various and favorable atmospheric and magnetic interactions. These lights are most visible at night near the poles and can happen when solar particles interact with gases in our atmosphere in just the right way. You can learn more about space weather and see forecasts at spaceweather.gov. Let's check out the research they do at the Global Monitoring Lab. The Global Monitoring Laboratory, or GML, is one of the Earth System Research Laboratories at the NOAA Boulder facility. GML conducts scientific research that addresses three significant scientific challenges: tracking greenhouse gases and understanding carbon cycle feedback, monitoring and understanding surface radiation, clouds and aerosol distribution, and guiding the recovery of stratospheric ozone. Measuring carbon dioxide in the atmosphere started before NOAA in 1958 in Mauna Loa, Hawaii. GML has now taken over this work and collects air samples to measure carbon dioxide, methane, and approximately 65 other atmospheric gases worldwide. Samples are collected in different ways. First, samples are collected by NOAA researchers 24 hours a day at GML's four observatories: Utqiagvik, formerly Barrow, Alaska; Mauna Loa, Hawaii; American Samoa; and the South Pole in Antarctica. Second, samples are collected using aircraft and tall towers by NOAA researchers and partners. Third, air samples are collected using a portable air sampling unit. The portable sampling unit is the size of a suitcase containing glass flasks that volunteers fill worldwide with an air sample. The air samples are then sent back to Boulder and analyzed at the GML laboratory. GML takes and receives over 20,000 air samples every year. The Air Core is another innovative atmospheric sampling system that consists of a long hollow tubing, usually in the shape of a coil, that can sample the surrounding atmosphere and preserve a vertical profile of the atmospheric gases from the ground to about 85,000 feet. The Air Core is launched into the air using a large weather balloon. Two Air Cores are launched simultaneously to allow cross-checking of the samples. Sensors in the unit detect when the balloon reaches its maximum height and opens a valve to the tube. While descending, the tubes fill with surrounding air. When the Air Core lands, the sensors detect the landing and close the valve, sealing the tube and preserving the sample. The samples are then sent back to the laboratory to measure. The GML also studies solar radiation, aerosols, water vapor, and ozone. In 1985, scientists discovered the ozone hole over Antarctica. Scientists figured out that the ozone hole was developing because of certain types of gases used in aerosol propellants and cooling devices, such as refrigerators. In 1987, these gases, called chlorofluorocarbons, were banned in a worldwide agreement called the Montreal Protocol. Researchers use an instrument called an ozone sonde to measure ozone in the atmosphere. Weather balloons with ozone sondes attached are launched near Boulder and from the four observatories to take ozone measurements. The balloons reach a height of about 100,000 feet before they pop and fall back to the ground with a parachute. Data is sent back to NOAA using a radio antenna. The Global Monitoring Laboratory's mission has always been to provide high-quality, long-term records of atmospheric composition to understand climate change better. You can learn more about this research at gml.noaa.gov. Let's go to our next tour stop. Science on a Sphere in the David Himes Planet Theater is a highlight for all visitors to NOAA Boulder. SOS was invented by Dr. Sandy McDonald, the retired director of the Earth Systems Research Laboratory in Boulder. It is a 6-foot white sphere surrounded by four projectors to create an animated Earth. We use it to show many things, such as clouds, ocean currents, Mars, and climate records. SOS is installed in over 175 locations around the world. SOS has a library of over 600 datasets, including 99 movies and 45 real-time datasets, so you can watch as hurricanes develop or watch snow conditions in real time. Datasets fall under the categories of space, air, land, snow and ice, and water. In addition to the globe, there is a flat-screen version called SOS Explorer that is easier to install. The SOS team also recently developed a mobile version called SOS Explorer Mobile. It is free to download and is in the Apple and Android app stores. Let's take a closer look at a few of the datasets on SOS Explorer Mobile. When you launch the app, you will first see the blue marble with real-time clouds. There is shading in the ocean, showing where the ocean is deeper and where it is shallower. You can also see topography, such as the rise of mountains. On the other side of the world, you see nighttime lights where the Earth is dark. How can we see the Earth in this way? A lot of our imagery comes from satellites. Here you can see a lot of the satellites that surround Earth. We can take away all of the satellites except the ones NOAA operates. Here are NOAA's satellites. There are two kinds. We have polar orbiting satellites that are close to Earth, and we have geostationary satellites called GOES, which are much farther away. One way NOAA uses satellites is to observe clouds. Here you see clouds with an overlay of radar to show rain and snow. Satellites can also tell us about temperatures on Earth. Here is the temperature on the ocean surface. You can see how warm the ocean is around the equator with direct sunlight, and how cold the poles are where there is less direct sunlight. Are these temperatures average? Warmer than average? Colder than average? That's what this data set is showing with temperature anomalies. The blue colors are areas colder than the 30-year average, using the years 1981 to 2010. The red colors are warmer than the same 30-year average. Additionally, using satellites, we can see change in Arctic sea ice over many years. Here, we show ice in just Septembers in every year from 1979 to last September. We have many more data sets you can check out at home, and we hope that you can someday visit the NOAA Boulder Science on a Sphere in person. Thank you for taking this tour with us today. I know we've already learned a lot, but we've barely scratched the surface on everything we work on here at the NOAA Boulder Laboratories. Whether you're interested in studying the ocean floor with our bathymetry team in the National Centers of Environmental Information, want to figure out what's in our air with the atmospheric chemists in our chemical sciences laboratory, are curious about using gravity to find the new sea level with the National Geodetic Survey team, or want to learn about drought with the Physical Sciences Laboratory, NOAA Boulder studies a wide range of subjects that influence the Earth system and our daily lives. There is so much more to see. Take a look around our outreach pages to learn more about all we have to offer. Have a good day and stay curious.